So it is over here.
I guess there was one more question where Supreet is asking he is not able to find the list.png file.
Madam, I have a question, ma'am.
Yes, sir, tell me.
Actually, I have tried to insert the item in a list whose size is limited. For example, my list have five vowels, A, E, I, O, U, and the last index is 4, but I have fetched the information from 6 or 7 index. Then it doesn't show any exception.
Okay, one thing you do, sir, whatever coding examples or queries we have, take a screenshot and put it in the classwork. We will go through each and every one's queries there. This so that way we will be able to do time management.
Okay, ma'am.
Thanks for your cooperation. So we'll take it offline. Now we have to deliver a lecture and also show the demonstration. So
madam,
madam,
my question is how to manage the exceptions and error. I want to learn exception handling in Python.
Whatever you have queries, that's what I'm saying. We'll take one to one because till tomorrow evening we have time. So all of you, please post your queries or whatever you want to learn. We will give you some material or whatever we know, we will tell you. But that we will do it in the class, Google Classroom. And snapshots, if you have got some error, please take snapshots and then paste it in the thing. So that
Very
way
much,
we
thank
can
you,
do
ma'am.
The
Very much, ma'am.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. So I will go ahead with our next lecture on the ML concepts, what are all the tasks. So this is what I was saying, the miscellaneous files here, it is there. And you
so madam, on the same context, basically we can see these files, but we have to specify the location of these files in the program.
So
right,
if you have opened like this, then just go and just save it as, save the image in your local. And once you open your Google Colab, not this one, where is it? So if you have opened that open Python notebook, that one you understood, no? The PNG file, you have stored it in your local drive, save it as, okay. Now once you open your Python notebook, left hand side you will get one folder icon which Upanika showed. Actually we have made a small video also for, see sir, here, this one. If you do this one here, through this you will be able to upload the file.
Okay, so this will be the case of PNG, but since the Excel sheet, which is in the form of CSV file, that cannot be just copied through the screen.
No. That one also you have to upload it in the CSV, and we will show you how to read the file. That you cannot do it, but here you have to use this arrow key to open a CSV file or PNG file, so it will take you directly to the local drive. But how to open CSV file in the program, that we will tell you in the next session, not now.
Okay, thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. So I shall start my lecture in the next topic. So thank you, and please communicate in the Google Classroom. Okay.
Madam?
Yes, madam.
It is better if Upanika madam presents.
Now also it is breaking.
If you speak continuously, the audio may not be clear, madam.
Just check once. If it is that way, then I will switch it off. Switch
okay.
It, so I will ask her.
Okay,
let
okay.
us try again, okay?
Okay,
now.
Okay, ma'am.
Are you able to see this?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So this is the machine learning concepts. Till now, I have told you overall the AI, the journey from this AI, and when you go ahead with this learning concept. Learning is one of the verbs, like knowledge. One is your knowledge representation component is there in AI. Then there is a reasoning in AI. Similarly, there is a learning in AI. So this is the learning concepts. So in the several concepts, components in is very common for any type of learning. You will have a set of input variables, and depending on the domain where you this input variable is also known as predictors in language of machine learning. They are also called independent variables in statistics. They are also called features in pattern recognition. So if you go through the research papers or any material, then all these three, predictors, independent variable, features, are nothing but input variables or input to the system. Now, set of output variables, one or more output can be there, where responses are also called in machine learning responses. In statistics, we say dependent variable. Say, for example, y is equal to x1 plus x2 plus x3. So y is dependent on x1, x2, x3, whereas x1, x2, x3 are independent variables. So in mathematics and statistics, this is very easy for you to understand. But now y, if it is x1, x2, x3 are features, and y is actually the response. So y is a response given the features x1, x2, x3. So you can rephrase this in any manner, but finally it is input variable and the output variable. Another important concept in dependent variable, that is the output variable, is quality or categorical. Qualitative means categorical, discrete. You also say factors. Quantitative means they are numerical in nature. So it is numerical, and the other ones are, so you can say a very tricky one, 0, 1. So 0, 1, is it quantitative or qualitative? So we are usually true and false, yes and no, they are considered to be two categories. So though they seem to be 0, 1 are numbers, they are categorical. And sometimes it is very easy for us to understand the categories excellent, good, fair, poor. So that is easy. And at the same time, if you are having only 4 or 5 options in your form, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, then they also become categorical, though they look quantitative. They are categorical. Then what is quantitative? Quantitative is like some numbers. So depending on the your square feet area of the land, the area in which the land is there, which city it is there, the price is computed. So the price is the output here. So that is quantitative. Okay. So is the audio okay now?
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
So now the thing is, I have put it in one. The first objective, what I am trying to learn from the data. So what I am trying to learn from the data, if I, it is based on some training, given certain examples, so that is called supervised learning. So based on certain features and predictor variables, the outcome variable is guiding the learning process. Say, for example, if you have got A1 in all the subjects, the output is A1 for your grade. Grade, say in class 1, you got grade A because you got all the five subjects grade A. So the outcome is based on the features, and you were told that now if all are A, then output is A. If two are B, then your output is B. Okay, and if your input is B, all three are A, you are still A. So you're trying to train yourself based on these inputs. It's supervised because you were already given the output value given certain specific inputs. So this is a training process. So you are trying to learn from the data. Again, the output variable can be quantitative or the categorical. So this supervised problem types, as I just now told you, the distinction in the output has led to a naming convention. So if you are trying to predict the grade or prediction you are trying to do, and if you are predicting a quantitative output, that is called regression. If you are trying to predict a qualitative output, that is categorical output, that is called classification. So representation of this qualitative output can be presented numerically by codes or targets. Say for example, two classes, 0, 1, minus 1 and 1. For more than two classes, you can use coding schemes, which we are not going in much details. You can use coding schemes like, you know, BCD code is there, where there, then you can use any 000010, like that. So you can use those coding schemes also. Okay, so that way you can get many combinations. Okay, so now the thing here, the crux is, if you are learning from the data and predicting the numerical value, then it is called regression. And if you are learning from the data and predicting a class as an output, it is called classification. So here the regression means you were trying to find out the coefficients of this particular line A0 and A1. Y is equal to mx plus c. So m and c, you are trying to, if you fix this line, this line will have a specific C, M slope and C. Okay, so these two coefficients are nothing but numericals. So you are getting two outputs for M and the, you are trying to calculate it. And then once you have the equation value, depending on whatever the X value, you are getting a Y. So the Y is nothing but a numerical value. So this is regression. You are trying to fit in a line for this type of data. Here in classification, you are seeing, given the features, if you, then this particular picture is a bull or this is a bear. So you are just classification, here it is in categories. Now coming to objective two, there can be another objective. I'm not saying these objectives are in sequence. They are not in sequence. I'm saying there can be multiple objectives. So in case you do not have any supervision, so using unsupervised learning based on set of features or predictor variables. Okay, so here you are actually trying to learn. So how you will learn? Here it is pattern recognition. Example, say this particular left hand side example, all these circles are there and I didn't map it that this is sad, this is happy, this is more sad, something like that. I didn't say anything. Neither I am saying that this is color based classification. I didn't say anything. I'm just giving these circles to you and didn't label that this is A, B, C, nothing I labeled. So now you have to find out this pattern. As an intelligent, rational human being, what you do is you put these three circles and anonymously everyone agrees to these three classifications. because everyone finds the same pattern. Everyone's model finds the same pattern. So this is unsupervised, okay? And here, similarly, this is the another one where you are having all of this. Again, you try to find a pattern and then separate it. But you do not say this is football, basketball, volleyball. I'm not saying anything. Names are not given. They are just here. Clusters are being found out depending on the pattern recognition. This is unsupervised. So this is also called clustering. So there are algorithms. K means clustering, hierarchical clustering. Basically, it is clustering algorithms. So now, what did we learn? We have learned that there is a ML tasks. ML means machine learning tasks, classification from data to classes. Like you can classify spam. This mail is spam. This is not spam. So there are two classes. Here, object detection is also one type of classification. You're trying to train a particular face recognition you are trying to do. So you are training Mr. X looks like this in various orientation. You train for that person Mr. X. Similarly here, you are given the car models and you train that this is a car in different orientation, because car may look like from the front side, everything. So this is again a classification, car or a face. Okay. So what I have written here is train each example and test with the new data. Okay. So here in the weather forecast, given a particular map with all the attributes, you have to say whether it is cloudy, sunny, rainy, like that. So weather forecast. Again, you are classifying it. News classification, seeing the article itself, you should be able to classify whether it's a food article, sports article, politics article. So this is all about the classification task. Coming to the next, regression. Regression is also supervised, where given some past data of a few months or years, you should be able to predict the numeric value. For example, the gold price, given the historical data, predict tomorrow's price. Given the historical data on stock exchange for a particular company, can I predict the stock value for tomorrow or day after tomorrow? So here I am predicting a numeric value, not any classes or categories. And this is also supervised because you are having a historical data. So this is called regression. Another ML task is clustering, which is unsupervised. Say for example, all these some 30 images have been mixed up. And now they are, the machine is asked, can you separate them into some classes? So it will ask how many classes you want. So if it says three classes, then it will separate out this as a class one, maybe predominant color is blue color, and this one is yellow and black, and this one is having a combination of green and blue. So it has found out three classes. In case it says only two, then I don't know whether this blue will be a part of class two. So these also may get distributed to class three. Okay, so this is called clustering. That means it is discovering the structure in the data. So it's already there. You are trying to dig in the pattern recognition. So this is part of pattern recognition. Everything, the words, buzzwords of pattern recognition, we are doing it. But sometimes we are doing it handheld manner, in supervised manner. Sometimes we are doing pattern recognition without being handheld. So that is called unsupervised. There can be certain interesting ML tasks like collaborative filtering. What is it? Say for example, you want to predict how well a user will like the other items based on the judgments of a community of user. I asked for to my Google introduction to R book, so it has given this R book and also told that people also searched for the program with R with data science, modern applied statistics, the new language R, and it has. So this is called collaborative filtering. If you try to give one item, then related item, depending on the community of earlier users, it will recommend. This is also called recommendation systems. So then there can be ML tasks in ranking. Ranking means finding similar images. So if you given now, if you go to Google, there you have image tab. Okay, in image, if you give your picture and try to search, you will get all your pictures whosoever has posted in Facebook, LinkedIn, or some functions, someone if it has posted in publicly. So what is it doing? It is not doing text match, it is doing an image matching. So finding similar images. So if you see in examples, the input is changing. Whether we are doing input has become from numbers to images. Similarly, you can do speech recognition. So your input media is changing from simple text to a multimedia. So that's how certain problems require more specialized algorithms when you are dealing with audio, video, and those things are going to the computer vision tasks. Okay, so a very small quiz. I am sure everyone will be able to do. You can do a self check. Email or spam, whether it is categorical or not. Dog, cat. So just put CC01. Now there is a cancer prediction. Whether he will survive or not, what percentage, depending on the this particular test, I am getting an output of a prediction rate. Small, medium, large. Stock price prediction. Handwritten digit recognition. So I'll give you the answers. I'm sure, pretty much sure you would have done good job. So these are all categorical. Because this is prediction in percentage, it is quantitative. Here small, medium, large is category, but it is also called ordered categorical, because large is somewhat related to this, medium size is related to the small size. It is not like if I say dog and cat, they are unrelated and they don't have any inbuilt sequence in them. So that's how in categorical there can be a type called ordered categorical. Okay, the stock price prediction, quantitative, and handwritten recognition is also categorical. Why? Handwritten means digit recognition. How many digits are there? 0 to 9, 10 digits. So you have 10 classes. So that is also categorical. So this is the mathematical definition for learning task. It is very easy. Here, as I told you, X is a vector. It is having many features. Output is denoted by Y. The qualitative outputs are meant for groups because it's category. So what is the learning task? Given the value of input vector X, make a good prediction of the output Y, denoted by Y hat. So Y hat means you have predicted. And what is Y? The actual output Y. So if your prediction is correct, then Y and Y dash is same. So the error in prediction Y minus Y hat is equal to 0. Okay, so this is how we also find the performance measure. It's in a very simple manner. Similarly, for categorical output G hat. And what is the, so you have classified the category as cat, and the output actual class of G was dog. So now this is not matching because you have found one, whereas the other answer is zero. So 1 minus 0, 1. So there is an error. So it is called misclassification. So there is a classification error, or you can say accuracy. So you will see many performance measures are there for the machine learning. Okay, so here another thing is there, quantitative output, if it is there, then you will get some number, whereas in qualitative error you will say it is a you will find out confusion matrix. What is confusion matrix? If it is true and you are saying positive, so it is correct, true positive, true negative, false positive, false negative, all these things are confusion matrix. In this workshop we are not going into detailed description about all performance measure, obviously it is not possible. We will just tell you where you have to see the performance measure, and we will try to educate that what are the performance measure for classification, what are the performance measure for your regression, what are performance measure for clustering. So that means the performance measures are different for different tasks, and it is quite obvious it will happen like that only. Okay, so here this is same, y is equal to f of x, it's a function. So finally the mathematics background people will say you have come down to mathematics only. So why? Given all these x1, x2, xn, you are trying to find a y where using a functional approximation. So finally, what is machine learning? It is nothing but a trying to find the best possible functional approximation for a given input, so that the prediction we are able to do it correctly. So this is what I was talking you in your demo, where f can be a linear function, non-linear function, higher degree polynomial. So the more higher degree polynomial we go, it tries to fit in everything. Okay, when you go to a lower degree polynomial, then one or two of the data points you may have missed out because it's a simple representation. A low degree polynomial is a simple representation. Okay, so now this is training data which helps us in constructing the prediction rules. So in the training data you are finding x and y both, x and g. G is nothing but categorical output. So the thing is, why both are there? Will it be there in the unsupervised? No, in the unsupervised I don't have any output category. From the xi itself, x1 to xn, I'm trying to find a pattern. This training data we will be using for your supervised learning, where you will be told given x1, x2, x3 values, this is the y1. Given another set of x values, this is y2. So now can you predict the value of y given xa, xb, xc, xd? So that's why these measurements are called training data, where you are given the values for x as well as the y. So this is for the same set. Okay, so this is an example from medical domain. What are the feature metrics? See, feature metrics, not to get confused, all these are features: age, size, thickness, and this is the target. The target is malignant. So target means output. So here the output is true or false. So that means output is only categorical, that is 0 or 1, true or false. So given these values, that is x1, x2, x3, this is y1. Another x1 dash, x2 dash, x3 dash, this is y1 dash, similarly. So this is called the training data. Now my model, you remember I discussed this algorithm and model. This is a model. Model means it is a prediction model. Given this input and output, it has learned what should be the patient age, tumor size and thickness, in which combination it becomes a malignant tumor. So that particular model has been designed. Now, if you give a test data, see 7233, it was not there here. 6644 also, it is not there. It may be there. It's not necessary. It has to be there or not there. But usually test data is not a part of the training data here. It is separately given. So now I am trying to guess through my cancer model whether it is malignant or not. So this is what is called the supervised learning training, and this is the test data. Now coming to integral aspect of ML model training data. See here, in your literature you will find there are parametric ML algorithms, non-parametric ML algorithms. Okay, so in brief, I'll just touch base these important concepts. See, algorithms that simplify the function f to a known form are called parametric machine learning algorithms. So here the linear regression, logistic regression, they are actually parametric forms, and you have a high bias. Parametric algorithms have a high bias, making them fast to learn and easier to understand, but they have lower predictive performance. So basically you have an idea of a function. Say for example, in your class, because I am a teacher, I always end up giving an example with the class. Okay, let me give some other example. You are sitting at the side of a lake and you see a black swan coming from one side. You think another one will also come, and you think that another one also will be black, a black swan, but a white swan comes. So then you think another black swan comes, another black swan. So now three black swans have come and one swan, white swan is there. You are trying to predict using a function because you're becoming quite biased that, okay, now I think there is a group of black swans only. So there is a parametric, means some form which is in your mind, and you try to fit in with that. Okay, whereas in non-parametric, algorithms do not make strong assumptions about the form of mapping function. So if I am a very open person, usually we are not judgmental, correct? So if we are not judgmental, we are free to learn any functional form from the training data. If you are judgmental, at the very first sight of one person, you try to become biased, then maybe if you are wrong, then you are gone because you don't understand that person at all. But if you are a non-judgmental person, you don't make judgment and you just try to learn non-parametrically, then now you see the last line. Non-parametric algorithms have a high variance and low bias. So that means because you were not judgmental, later on you have found that person is whatever you were judging or not judging, at a very high or a very low, but you gave that person a chance. For example, when you have customer satisfaction and related to a particular marketing agency, so if you are judgmental with a particular brand, then you won't with any other brand, because you are biased towards one brand only. And even if you could have got a higher returns, your variance is very low because your bias is high. Whereas in non-parametric algorithms, you are free to use any brand, let me try this or that. So you have a high variance, because somewhere you got very high returns and somewhere you got low returns because you are low biased person. So which is flexible, non-parametric or parametric? So obviously, when you are less biased person or less biased algorithm, then it becomes more flexible and we achieve better accuracy. Why? We are not stuck with a local result. We become more global. Okay. But it requires a lot of data and training time. Yes, it will require a lot of data and training time because you're trying with many options. Okay. So when you have a complex problem, it works good. So I'm not going into mathematical part, but remember, this parametric means you will be giving some input. For example, if you know you must have heard about Gaussian distribution, where it looks like a bell curve, and that bell curve is having two parameters. What are the two parameters? Mean and standard deviation. So if I now tell you, give me a graph with mean 0 and standard deviation 1.5, you can picture something. Give me another diagram with mean 0, standard deviation 5. Now you get a fatter bell curve, isn't not? So that means you are putting some parameter values and then trying to guess the function. So that is parametric. Okay, so here example, so machine learning algorithms also, they are also trying to be like a human being now. So they also think like us, whether I become biased or whether I become low, I have a low bias, high bias. So there are algorithms like support vector machine, neural network, decision trees, k nearest neighbor, which are non-parametric algorithms. So these so-called algorithms are having high variance, low bias, whereas this linear regression, logistic regression, it is a high bias and low variance. Okay, so now the thing is, what actually is our target? A very good predictive modeling machine learning algorithm is to achieve low bias and low variance, is it not? We want to be a free bird, free thinking. At the same time, we want to have a low variance in our expectation. If I am thinking this is a very good, everything is good, and finally a variance is suddenly coming, COVID time, before that we never thought that such a big variance will be there. So, but again, because we have low bias, the show must go on. And we still do our all daily routine work, official work in this type of situation also. Though there is so much variance could have happened, but no, we are still having a low variance and we are also not a biased personality, we are having low bias. So all these thinking philosophically can be transformed to machine learning also. Otherwise, the predictive modeling also has to be similar to that of human being. So the bias are the simplifying assumptions made by a model to make the target function easier to learn, is it not? If we become a little biased, it is easy also for us. Variance is the amount that estimate of the target function will change if different training data are used. So different training data, the variance will be changing. Now, this is one very important central limit theorem in statistics, actually. the why we need it. Basically, when we say what is the average happiness index of Indians, do you think you can go to billion people and take the survey? No. You will take a handful of the people and try to find out the happiness index and then justify that, okay, so this must be the happiness index from 1 to 5. Indians are usually happy index is 3.5. So that system may not have come to any one of us in this participant list, but still it has published the value 3.5. So the very important concept is here is what I'm trying to say is population and sample. So actually there is a population, and now in that population you take a sample and try to predict. So when you are doing this, what is the standard error? How you can reduce the standard error? So as the sample size grows, the distribution becomes more like a normal distribution, with the mean of the sample more likely to be the mean of the population. Okay, so when the means of the sample and means of the population are same with a less standard error, that means we have got true representative of the population in the selected sample. So let me see whether this is basically a parent distribution, and here if you take only one sample, when you draw it will be, because you have taken each one of it, it will be same distribution it will look like. Now what is the mean? 50. Okay, so here increase the sample size and standard deviation is 28. I want to know what is the sample mean and the population mean. If we draw, then this is the Gaussian curve. So here this what it says is when you increase the size of the sample, howsoever your parent population looks like, you will see that the size, the shape looks like a Gaussian and with this less standard deviation. So if you increase this, so for any type of here the parent population was looking different size shape, but if you see the central limit theorem, in the central limit theorem it is calculating the sample mean and this is also 50 and with standard deviation 6.5. if you increase it to 30, the standard deviation is now more less. Okay, so here let me go to if you see here the implications of normal Gaussian distribution, how it is important. The normal distribution is represented by bell-shaped curve with 68% distribution lying within one standard deviation. This is minus 1 to 1. This is the 68% of the data. 95% lying within two standard deviation, minus 2 to 2, 95%. And 99.7% lying within three standard deviations. So that means whole population has come into it. The whole population has almost come into it. Okay, so this is one of the examples. The IQ, the intelligent quotient. So here your mean is this one, and this is the standard deviations x-axis. IQ has been designed to have a mean of 100 and standard deviation close to 15. So your IQ is anywhere between 85 to 115. You would be considered within one standard deviation. Okay, mean is 100. 100 plus 15, 115. 100 minus 15, 85. So with one standard deviation, 85 to 115 is the crowd. So 68% of the population here is between 85 to 115. Now what happens with two standard deviations? So here you will say 100 plus 15 into 230. So 130. So if you see, this will be a genius level IQ, genius level IQ. Okay, now what is 70 IQ would be two standard deviation below the mean. Okay, so here 100 minus 30, that is 70. So what is the interpretation? It may cause, it is a concern because it represents mental retardation. Okay, so this is how from a big population, if you take a sample with mean and standard deviation, only two parameters, you are able to predict or you are able to draw a conclusion or a picture about that particular problem statement. Okay, so that is why this is very important. Law of large numbers. As the size of sample is increased, the more accurate the estimate the sample mean will be to that of population mean. So collecting more and more data will lead to a more representative sample. So the central limit theorem does not state anything about a single sample mean. It is broader and states something about the shape of the distribution of the sample means. So that's what we have seen in our demo. Whatever is the parent distribution, the shape of the sample mean will always look like a Gaussian bell curve. So let us see how this helps in machine learning. As I told you, if in the training data, if it is not a true representative, and then you build a model on that and you test it, will the evaluation be correct? No. So how we know how much training data we want? How much training data we want so that we get a robust model? So this is what is the training data. The data used to train the model must be representative of the observations from the domain. The test data, the thoughts given to the training data set must also be given to the test data. This is often neglected because every time we use, splits, 80/20 splits. So 80% goes to training data, 20% goes to test data. And there is also a concept of cross-validation so that you can also next round, this 80% will be a different collection, 20% will be different collection. In the next epoch, 80% will be different collection. So that's what is the cross-validation, so that you are, so that each and every sample becomes sometimes a test data, sometimes a training data. Okay, so model skill evaluation. It highlights the need to develop a sample of multiple independent evaluations given a model and that mean reported skill from the same isn't accurate enough for the population mean. So there is a sample mean and the population mean. We are also doing an evaluation on that. So here if an example from finance I have taken. You know the insurance premium. Are filling in so much premium. If required, will the company be able to pay you back? So the law of large numbers helps us to avoid credit risks and maintain stable premiums. How it is doing? It is doing by increasing the customer base. That's why you will see so many agents are there, so and really a wholesome business. The more the customer base, the that way you avoid the credit risk. So this is what is the law of large numbers, which applies in our real financial domain, in our machine learning. To this is concept is from the statistics background. So I just thought of touch basing some statistics like central limit theorem, law of large numbers also. So here the thing is bias variance. I already discussed. You will be hearing this word very frequently: overfitting, underfitting. Okay, so overfitting, underfitting is basically both are called deficiencies of ML model. Both are deficiencies of ML model. Overfit means that is, say for example, you want to classify the flowers. You have told this, given a training data with all sorts of flowers, okay, and now it has memorized each and every feature of the rose, lily, everything, and it has fitted it more than required. Now in test data, you give a cauliflower. So it sees this particular cauliflower was not in the training data, and it has tuned itself so much that it is not able to understand whether the cauliflower is a flower or a vegetable. Okay, if you are having less bias, underfitting, just seeing the diagram of the cauliflower, it would have told this is a flower. When you have overfitted, then it may say it is not a flower. So sometimes there are species which look like a flower but is not a flower, which looks like vegetable but is a flower. All these outlier conditions, how they can be handled. So we have to tweak into the model, whether we have to have a generalized model or whether we should have a specialized super fit model, that is the question. So when you are overfitting, it leads to more bad than the good. And for underfitting, it is high bias, that is better. Okay, so we just don't know, depends on the task to task. A model that generalizes well is a model that is neither underfit nor overfit. If you are prepared for an entrance exam and you are always given those questions in question paper, and if that question paper question doesn't come, though the concept is same, you may have got overfitted. But if you know the concepts and whatever question comes, you are able to answer. So that is, you have truly known the concept, so you are able to fit into yourself with any questions. So you have not memorized that. So this is the concept of, should we use overfit, should we use underfit. So this is the statistics for estimating an underlying polynomial that describes the observations. This one I have already told you. So this is what, again, this thing also is there. So this is overfit. See, this is overfit. I had to go to a higher degree polynomial to fit everything. If I have done like this, still it is better, no? Still it is doing good. Still it is doing good, good with the quadratic one. Yes, it is good. So I am happy with this. But if I increase it, see? So yeah, I am overfitting. So this is the concept of overfitting. See how many coefficients I have generated. And if I decrease it, so here what I am trying to say is, this is more of a underfit. Why underfit? There are certain points which do not lie on this particular curve, but they are nearby. Okay, so this is what the example of overfit and underfit also is telling. So another integral, okay, the same thing. We always want to find the trend, not fit the line to all the data points, true or false. just think about it. We always want to find the trend, not fit the line to all the data points. True or false? So I am saying, what is the trend? It is increasing trend. I am not trying to fit in all the data points. I am not interested. I want to see the trend. That's it. Understood. So here the answer is yes. I want to see the trend only. Now next, it happened like that. Oh. So it is coming down. Maximum I can increase to 100. So it has come down. So that's what I am saying here. The meaning here is yes, I want to find the trend, not fit the line to all data points. Otherwise, I'll be overfitting. Classification regression are interchangeable. Discuss. See, if you have a regression, okay. If you have a regression, and again, I'll take this one. This is a line. Now, if I say till 3, this is grade A, 7, grade B, 10, grade C. So A, B, C. So a regression can be also converted to classification by using a threshold. And then from this particular 0 to 3, A, 3 to 7, B, 7 to 10, C. That's what I meant here. So sometimes you will see some of the algorithms, they are used for classification as well as regression because they are interchangeable depending on the problem statement. Say for example here for a two class G binary coded. So you are having a typical 0 to 1, many values are there. Can I have a binary class? Yes. If my greater than 0.5, it is class 2, less than 0.5, it is class 1, that's it. So initially it was a regression thing and you could have made it also a classification. Yes, I think I am done with the ML tasks. Thank you for your patience hearing.
Thank you so much, Tilottama madam. Without a single full stop, you have presented so well, madam. Wonderful session.
Thanks to the audio.
Yes,
yes. But this time.
By today's session, people got a clear picture about the difference between supervised and unsupervised and clustering and regression.
Okay. So now in our next topic, we will be showing you the visualization. So in the visualization, how you can plot, it will be useful later on. This is a certain different topic. So tomorrow when we are going through each of the algorithms and the machine learning code, you will be able to correlate the code and whatever we have discussed.
Madam, there is one question here from Ashish Sagar. Is it possible to understand significance and real world meaning of standard deviation and mean?
Understand significance
and real world meaning, not mathematical, of standard deviation and mean. Uponika madam has already answered. Yes. When we get to real time data, we do check various statistical parameters.
You mean to say standard deviation, what is mean? Significance means, for example, I'll tell you, if you are having a class, okay, if you are having a class with the highest number marks obtained is 90 and the lowest marks obtained is 40. Okay, so that means you have two strata of student. One is very good, another is not so good. Another class, section B, highest number is 90 and the lowest number is 70. Here the standard deviation is less. Okay, for example, hypothetically I am telling for both the classes the mean is 80. So in the two cases mean is 80, but the standard deviation tells you about the significance of the class that the section B is better than the section A.
Madam, we
so
are not
that means that means this lesser standard deviation is better.
Yes, sir. Yes, sure. No, better okay. means it is not better or good. It is a study of the data. We cannot say better or good. I am just studying the nature of the section. Correct, sir. So I will just put a mark that the section B is having your good students rather than the section A, because section A the standard deviation, though the mean is. Both are equal, but the standard deviations are higher in the section A than the section B. So this is just an analysis. We can say them as a data analysis.
That's a great explanation, madam. So at the same time, this mean, that means mean is an average?
Yes, mean is average.
Okay.
Average. Because you have outliers, once you have outliers, then the standard deviation increases, correct? Outliers means suddenly you have a very bright student who gets always 100 and one very poor student who always is somehow able to pass. So these two outliers always actually makes a standard deviation more prominent.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so basically the similar meaning I was able to understand for variance as well. So what is the difference between the variance and standard deviation in this case?
It's a square. It's both are same. It is just the sigma and the square of it.
Okay.
That statistically you will be able to do that part.
Okay, so when we have been talking about y is equal to function of x, and as we were changing the amount of data, okay, for the training or maybe for supervised learning, so in that case x square, x to the power 3, so the graph which we saw that shown the value of y which can vary with respect to the exponents of the x, right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Correct.
So with large amount of data, prediction can go wrong. I mean, that's the overfitting which you're talking about.
When you are having large number of data, do I try to fit in all the data? That is my question. If I try to fit in all the data in a line, that line cannot be a line. It has to be a curve.
Correct.
Correct. So the more the complex curve it is, that is higher order polynomial, because I'm trying, and higher order polynomial complexity computational will be higher. So in my whole machine learning thing, it becomes very complex system. At the same time, if I am happy with the quadratic parabola itself, then maybe few of the points don't fit into that parabola, but it's okay. There will be certain standard error. We can put a threshold in the error and we are happy with that much error, but still the system will be fast in learning and it will be efficient. That's what I meant in one of the discussion point. We are not trying to fit in all the data, but we are trying to find a trend. I hope it answers to your question.
Absolutely, ma'am. Absolutely. We are trying to identify the trend and pattern.
Yes, sir. So, yes, sir. Correct.
Yeah. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Okay, so we shall move to the next session of visualization tool by Uponika. Uponika, over to you.
Yeah. Hi, everyone. So I will be showing you some tools that we generally use for machine learning, and we use it for visualizing various stuffs. Like, first thing I would say that when you are having a data and when you want to do something like some concepts you want to implement on it, so what do you basically do? The first thing that you do is check your data, like what you have in your hands. Then you go for the things that you want to achieve. You want to make the task on and different other solving the other problem statements. So when you have the data, how it is very important to know how well you know the data, because more good you know your data, more you are comfortable to work on the different task that you are about to do. So when we are checking the data, we have various, as ma'am was explaining in the last session, in the last lecture, that what are the supervised data, unsupervised data, what is classification, regression. But the thing is, first, before that, we have to understand what kind of data it is and what is there in the data set. And most importantly, how the data is distributed into different, what are the features of the data. And to know all these things, I guess, to human brains, it is very important to, you know, the more image we give to the human brain, it understands it more. So when we have some visualization in front of us of the data, we understand it more than a textual format. So that's where visualization comes. And as I was telling about Python, and Python was, I was discussing some various basic fundamentals, concepts and syntax of Python, how to read variables, tuples, dictionaries, and so on. So this, again, this Python has its own libraries. Okay, so it has its different libraries, which is responsible for visualizing the data that you have. So your data can be in a different way. Okay, you may not know, it can be, as ma'am was telling, it can be of the text, it can be from media, it can be from anything. So what you need to know is, you need to go through the data completely, and you need to visualize the data. So first, let me just show you very few basic fundamentals of visualization, how to plot your data, how to understand a data, how it is scattered, how it is distributed, how your features are there. And sometimes also it is very important that all the features are not important for us. Okay, like suppose you have a diabetes data set. Okay, so in your diabetes data set, you have various other features like insulin level in your blood, glucose level in your blood, age, like, you know, skin color, and then pregnancy state. Then there are various other factors. But do you really think the skin color makes any difference to the diabetic patient, if the patient is diabetic or not? No, right? So that depends, like, how much data is also required for us, because unnecessarily we don't want to waste our storage with the data that is not required, because ultimately it's all about modeling. And ultimately, it's all about the training and performance. So more unnecessary data we put, more it will be biased. And our aim is anyway to reduce the biasness. So before all this thing, first, let me show some basic techniques, how we can, visualize our plots and everything. So I'll share my screen. This is also there in the I have uploaded one notebook in your of Google Colab in your day one, where you can find under the visualization tools. So if you go, my screen is visible. Can anyone give a response?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you. So here is the material where you can see the demonstration of visualization tool notebook is uploaded. So I will open with a Google Colab.
Just to let you know that we are able to see your camera, not the screen.
Okay, so you're not able to see my screen?
It is visible, madam.
Can you see my screen now?
Yes, it is visible. Better everyone request you to pin the presentation.
Yeah. Okay, so here is the notebook. So I have given it as Matplotlib. Okay, so before starting, I would like to first tell what are the different packages that this Python is having on visualization. So it has various packages. Okay, so you can have Matplotlib, you have even NumPy. NumPy is basically a package which does a lot of things. It can it is there for your numerical operations that you do on Python with your data set, and also it has its own few you know, like visualization tool. Matplotlib is completely based on visualization. It will give you all the different plots and graphs, so it's completely colorful package. And another is also there, Seaborn library. So it is on your choice how you, which library you want to go through. So I have taken for an example this Matplotlib. I'll be showing you the different how to plot. Basically, first thing, we'll start with that. So, and when you are having your notebook, so first thing you have to do is it will not be there as an initial library in your package in your Python. Okay, so you have to explicitly install this library. So this is very easy. Again, like either you can go with your Conda install Matplotlib, or if you are using a Jupyter notebook itself, then you can just go with a pip install Matplotlib. So this command will make you to install the complete Matplotlib package. And once you are once you install this package, then you can get the all the flavors inside it. So first, what you have to do is you have to import package. This is very important. When you are starting with any Python notebook, you have to import the required packages, whether it would be a visualization or it can be any, you know, pandas or any kind of libraries. So you have to import it. So you have to import this from matplotlib package.pyplot, and you have to, I gave the alias name as PLT. So you can give any kind of any name which you are comfortable in typing in the next half of your work, so that you don't have to type every time pyplot.this, pyplot.that. So it makes the things easy. So just give a short nickname to it. So I have given PLT. And one more thing, we are using Jupyter notebook, so that's why we have to use this command matplotlib inline. So this will ensure that you are getting a good view of your plots that you are carving. Because if you are using the normal command prompt, you can get it from plot.show. But that is all about when you are using in the local system. But if you are using notebook, because it is always an online thing, and you can get it on the you know, like on online thing, so you have to always get it in the inline command. Okay, so first I won't go with one data set and show you everything, because anyway we are going to do it tomorrow. But before that, I would come with a very small example of an NumPy array. Okay, so I'll come with an array. The array I have created through a NumPy, and then we will see that how it works. Okay, so similarly I have added the library of NumPy and added one alias name for it as np. So import NumPy as np, and there inside your NumPy you will have different functions. So these all thing you have to explore from the NumPy documentation itself in the website, NumPy website. They will be giving different functions. You will get numerous function where it will have different in those function you can use in for different operation. So my function is zero line space. In this we are giving three different arguments, 0, 5 and 11. So what is it basically is 0 to 11, it is going to take I mean a 0 to 5, as again it is a kind of start value and end value, it is going to take 11 items. Okay, so how it is dividing it as you can see once you are running this command, that x is the values are 0, 0.5, 1, 1.5, 2, 2.5, and so on. So till 5, you are getting 11 items. And Y is one more array, which is storing the square of each element that are present in X. Okay, so X is the least, which is in this list, we will be having from 0 to 5, 11 elements. And Y is one more list where the square of the elements of X will be stored. Okay, so I'm running it. So I have got X and Y. So this is enough for me. Okay, I have my input and output. Now I want all about to plotting, because I want to focus this lecture on plotting. So I don't want to show you what how we want to get X and Y from data sets, because we will go through in the next chapters. So these are the basic matplotlib commands. Okay, so as we have initialized our matplotlib as plt, so this plt.plot, that means that plot function in the package matplotlib will make you to plot your X and Y function. Okay, so you have already defined your X, you have already defined your Y, and now you are also defining a color. So you have defined R as a color. R is standing for red color. Now you can give your blue, you can give yellow, and any color of your choice, so that it will plot you X and Y in that particular color. Okay, but it is just not enough. You also have to label your X, you also have to label your Y. So what is X, what is Y? You have to write that thing, titles. Okay, so for writing that, it will be plot.xlabel, and then you are writing the string, the title of X, and then Y label, where you are inserting the title of Y. And also it's better if you can give a title to the plot to understand what this plot is all about. And then plt.show will make you print the plot. Okay, so let's try. Okay, cool. So we have got a red color plot. So try the blue color plot. We have got a blue color plot. Okay, so now we will see. So our plot is now ready. Now what we can see is, why can't we see for two different plots? Okay, so now this concept is called as subplots. Subplot is something like, you know, it is something an internal of a plot. This is one outside major plot, and then there are two inside inner plots. These are called as subplots. So when you are having subplots while writing or coding that subplot command, you will come through the syntax like, what are the X and Y's in that? So in that X and Y place, you have to write the n rows and n calls. That means the number of rows you want to give for a subplot and the number of columns you want to give for a subplot. So for on that basis, it will make you to plot one. Suppose in this example, we have taken 1, 2, 1. So for the first subplot, see, this is the plot number. That is the first subplot. Okay, so for the first subplot, my number of rows is 1 and my number of column is 2. Similarly, and then we are plotting X, Y, and R. Okay, that means the first plot. The first plot we are getting in the red, and that is a, these are double dashed file, I mean dashed plot. So you are also, you can also give this kind of notation to represent which kind, which type of plot you want, whether you want a dashed one, whether you want a straight line, or we want a star that we have used for the second plot, that is a star and dash. So for the second plot, we have come with a star and dashed, and the color is green. And this one, we have taken the first one column, one row, two column, and in this one we have changed the, see, you can see the sequence here, it is Y and X. So this plotting is Y and X, but the previous plot was X and Y. So if you can match, this is just an opposite, this is just a reverse of the first plot. The second plot is a reverse of first plot. Well, now matplotlib, yeah, this is, as we have said previously, that Python is an object-oriented programming language. So similarly, the package that is there inside it, that is matplotlib itself, is an object-oriented programming language. So if you have create one object in matplotlib, you can use that object into different other areas to get the, you know, to extract the features in the respective fields. So first, let us do one thing. Let us create a figure. So how we do that? Like fig equal to plot.figure. This function be able to give you a empty canvas. Empty canvas is something like an empty plot where you will not plot any of the x and y. You don't have anything, it's just blank. And then you are going to add axis. Axis is very important. Axis is something that makes you to understand the complete layout of your plot. Okay, so the first layout of the plot will always have a, and it always comes in a sequence of left, bottom, width and height. Okay, and it always comes from the range 0 to 1. So if you have a range of 0, then your axis will be starting from 0 and it can only run till 1. So any value within this can be your axis value. So first you will plot the left axis, and then you will give the bottom axis, and then the width and the height of the plot. Okay, so let's do one thing. How can we if you have an axis, so as we were telling, we can do plot plt dot x label, and we can label our x axis similarly for the y axis. But see, this thing we can also do as an object orientation. How? Because axis has become the object where we have initialized this fig.add axis. So now it is the complete axis. Now in this axis, we are able to set the x level and y level. So these are the functions to set the x and y level, where you can put the title for x and y level. And also, don't forget to give a title for the entire plot, because it makes a sense what plot it is of. Because this is just only one plot you are seeing right now, but when you will have a real-time data, you will be having a lot of plots. So you'll get confused which plot you are seeing and what it is all meaning. So it's better if you give a title. Okay, now let's come to the next part. So we want to create one subplot. So as we were telling previously how we can make two different plots, now we can see a plot inside a plot. That means we already have a major plot, main plot, and then inside it we want to create one inset axis. So the first axis, the main axis, should be should have its own parameters values, and then you keep one value which is for the axis 2 that will come inside it. So that's how these two have got initialized. And then it is the same thing that you have how you have got object as it is an object orientation. So you have got object and how you have initialized for each and every object. Similarly, you're going to make it your object 1. This is your object 2. And then for each and every level, go it for either for object 1 or for object 2. But the function remains the same. So if you run this, you will get two different axes, one inside the other. So this is also almost doing the same thing, where you are giving a subplot fig and axis. See, you can see both the objects, both two variables are there, and both are taking this object plt and the function as subplots. So both are coming as to be the subplots. Okay, and when you are taking axis, now your object name is axis, so you are accessing your visualization frame with the axis tool, which is already being initialized by the subplot. Now you can get through the different functions like x, y, set level, x and y level, and title. So this is almost the same thing that we have done for the previous one. Okay, so we'll come with the subplots with n number of rows and n number of columns. Previously we were saying that we were not mentioning the number of rows and number of columns, but now we are mentioning it. Okay, for the subplots, now first, if I am mentioning n number of rows as 1, that means 1 row, 2 column. So in this 1 row, I am seeing 2 different subplots. So if I am running this, 2 columns. But what if I do like 2 rows, 2 columns? There are 2 rows and 2 columns in each of the rows, correct? So similarly, you can go with any of the thing. can go with three rows, two columns, so you'll get three rows and two columns out of it. Okay, how to iterate through an axis? If you have different axes, if you have two different axes, how do you iterate it? So you, as you have seen, we have done two subplots, okay? So in that two subplots, we have two different axes in it. So first, again, it comes the looping structure. When I'm looping into the axis, that means for the first structure, see, if you can see over here, for AX in axis, it is my loop variable. Okay, so first it takes the value of 1. When the value is 1, so what it does, for the first axis, it initializes these variables. It initializes all these things. And then it loops back and go to 2. And then it initializes again the same variable. So we are getting the same characteristics in both the value, in both the axes. So sometimes while doing this, what you are going to face is these both are getting overridden, like overlapping is happening. You can't see this Y, and it is coming some disturbance is happening in between this. Y is going to go that side. So what you want to do is, to avoid this kind of interruptions, you can go with a fit tight layout. So this is tight layout is a kind of function which makes you to give a proper view of your axis, which makes an individual view of the subplot. Okay, so now you can see there is a gap between this Y axis in this plot and this plot of this axis. Okay, now you want to see that there are different plots are there, but what if there are different what are the sizes of each plot? So yes, we have also some function which allows us to check the size of the plot, and there is, you know, dot per inch, that is a pixel per inch. This is we call as DPI. So what is this all about is, suppose we have a plot. Okay, so we have a plot where we have initialized, for an example, as 8,4. So what is this 8 is standing for? 8 stands for the width of the figure. Okay, how the plot width will be. And 4 stands for the height of the figure. Okay, basically the y-axis, how much height and the figure can be of. So when you are plotting this, so you are storing your value, the fig, in. So your fig is, you are storing the sizes in your fig value. Okay, now you have fig size given as 12,3. Okay, so you will get a figure something of size like this. Yeah. Let us do some trial and error. Let us just reduce the size of it. So this is the width, right? So I don't want such a stretched figure. I want something little low. So let's try with this. Okay, so it got reduced. Okay. One more thing is also important, that saving a figure. When we have different figures, sometimes our use case is like we have to save some picture that we are generating. We have to save the figure. So how are you going to do that? So it is again coming into the file handling part. So there is a simple process where you have already the fig object being initialized previously, and then you have a function save file. Now go for a simple file name that you want to go for. So I have, for an example, gave a file name .png. So if I run this one, this is going to be my this is going to be saved. But where you can see in the saved, you can look over here. See, it is a file name .png. So it got saved over here. Okay. So again, we can just make any changes in the fig size, in the DPI, in different folders we can go, and we can change the figure size and we can save accordingly. Okay, now we'll go through some other things like legends. So what is legends? Okay, so now we have two different plots. Okay, so in a single axis, in a single frame, we have two different plots. Now, how would you differ that this is for this plot, this is for that another plot? So you need to name them, right? You need to name this for figure A, this for plot B. So plot A and plot B has to be different. So for doing that is nothing but called as legend. So when we set a title for frame, we add label as X and Y, and then we'll go for legend X. Okay. So we have a figure in which we have this plot dot figure. So we are plotting one figure out of it, and then there is an AX in this object. We are adding an axis. That means this will be the frame. Our axis size will be our frame size, and in that our X is taking the value that we have initialized, and our Y we didn't initialize. Our Y is nothing but square of X. Okay, so and our level here, we are giving the level as this name. The name of the level we are giving as X, this one, this string. Okay, here you can give any other string anyway. And then my second plot is taking my X variable as X and my Y variable as a cube of X. Okay, and then my level name is this one. So when I'm running it, and yeah, we have to give a function as ax.legend. So when I'm running it, you can see there are two different colors of plot. The one is a blue, another is a orange. So the blue one is an X, the string that we have mentioned over there, and the other one for the blue one. So we are getting the two different, one for the square, another for the cube. So with legends, we have got various other things to do. Okay, we can put our legends in any of the place in our plot. Like for this plot, as our complete thing is in the, you know, like orange and blue in this part, area part. So our upper left corner is little bit empty, so we can put our legend over here. Similarly, if any of the plot will have this this area being completely occupied, you can keep this plot in different other area. So basically, there are various, I have mentioned here, if LOC, that is a look, LOC, this parameter is equal to 1, that means it will take the upper right corner. If LOC equal to 2, it will take the upper left corner. And so for 3, it will take the lower left corner. And so for 4, it will take the lower right corner. Okay, so let me check with LOC 2. It should take the upper left corner, which is already there. Let me check something else. Maybe I'll check it 3. My legend coming the lower left corner. Okay, but it is not recommendable because it will overlap your plot exactly plot, and because of that, it will create confusion of your visualizing and analyzing the data. So it's better to keep the legend wherever there is a free space. So every time you can just go for different colors and different kinds of plot, either the dotted, or you can go for dashed plot, or various other, whichever you, which makes you feel a different in your understanding. It's all about your understanding. Like, you know, when you are given some data, then the only thing that matters is how well you are understanding your data. So do whatever you want to do, but just understand the data. That's important. Okay, so there are some other RGB hex codes are there. You can also go for the color codes if you're not writing the exact colors. So for a particular plot, see here we have taken like x value, and for the y value I have taken x plus 1, and for the x plus 2, and for the third plot I have taken x plus 3. But for the three different plots, there are three different color mentioned. And for the colors, see, you can see it is also the blue is there, and alpha is 0.5. What is this alpha is all about? Alpha parameter takes about the how much transparent your color is. Okay, so 0.5 is like half transparent. It is not completely transparent, but in middle of it. So that is your first plot is all about. Second plot takes a RGB hex code. which is giving you a violet line, and the third one is a yellow one, the orange one. So it is anytime, anyway, you can give your hex code also, or else you can write your color names also. So these are various styling techniques that you can do to visualize your data, to understand it in a better way. So there are various plots, there are various things, so you can just explore this. I have already uploaded it, so explore it in your way and just do trial and error method, check how these things are working. So these are again, you know, like access ranges. So what you are trying to do is, like in this, you have 0, 1, 2, 3. So as I can, as I said, you, it is not taking the ranges, but it is taking for the first because they have mentioned first one row, three plots. Okay. So for the one row, three plots, I have three different plots, and for the each and every plot, there are different customization. So for that thing, they have given each and every different layout, and also the name. See, one is a default access ranges, the title is a default access ranges for the first plot, so that's why it is in the axis zero. Okay, for this plot, their x and y is different, so they have plotted different x and y's. Okay, two different x and y's together, and also you can see for the second plot, we can see again the x and y's are different, where you can see one x and the y is the square of the x, and for the second plot, the x and the y is a cube of x. Okay, and there it has mentioned it as a tight axis has to be the title, and the different one for the third one, where they have given custom axis as to be their range. And in this, you can see here they have mentioned the limits of the x and y. So they have come up with, see, 0 to 60 the limit is for the y. So we can see the y limits are 0 to 60, and for the x the limit is from 2 to 5. That means they are coming up with 2 to 2.5 3.5, and like this 2 to 5. So this is also a very good example for you to understand the plottings inside. And after this, once you are done with all the things, there will be coming that phase when you will deal with your data. Now you have your entire data, and in that data you have got your different features, and in that features you are going to understand your feature. Okay, so how the features are distributed, how what is it a linear distribution in the feature, or is it a very random distribution? So each and every feature need to be understood. Okay, so need to be analyzed. So to do that, we always do some scatter plotting. Different kinds of plottings are there. Okay, so we do some bar plot, histogram, scatter plot, pie chart, and various other plotting techniques are there. And one more thing, for plotting there are two different sections. One is a like for one particular feature. Another is like for the different features. Like two different features can be plotted together to see how these two features are related to each other, and how to visualize what is the relation between these two features, whether these two features are improving each other, or they are just pushing down each other, or they're fighting between each other. So it all about how these two features are working. So there are two and another types of plots where you can find the multiple features, where the more than two features, like four or five features, come together and you can see the complete visualization. So It is vast. Okay, visualization is vast. It is just a basic thing that I am showing you. So you need to explore a lot about these things. And I just gave a little flavor of different plots here, just like a scatter plot, how it is all about. If I have an X and Y, then my X and Y will be distributed in scatteredly like this way. And it is, we can see this is a linear distribution, and how they have taken care of this distribution is by through a scatter plot. Now there is some other examples of bar and bar chart also. So in this bar chart, this is an histogram chart actually. This is an histogram where my data is just a random selection of numbers. Okay, so I haven't given any some x and y, but there is some x random selection. So for my sample, the data x is ranging from 1 to 1000, and my y is 100. Okay, so how my data is running uniformly? So these are all the examples that we are giving. These are all hard-coded examples where we have given 1 and 100 and all. But in real time, you will not get 100 or you will not get 1,000. These numbers you will not get. You will get the data sets. Okay. There, anyway, we will deal with the in the next lectures how to deal with the data sets one. So this is for an example, like how for the numerical data sets, how this generally works. So you can see a histogram over here, how the spread is happening between the X and Y and how this plotting is happening. Okay, so the same thing is happening with a box plot. So see, in the box plot we have got data and well, this data is having this, you know, this random function I have taken. So numpy.random function will randomly choose different values and it will choose the values from zero. And you, if you can see, for all the graphs, for all the plotting, there is a zero mean. That means the mean is zero and it has the plot between, you know, see, for the standard in the range 1 to 4. So here I can see from 1 to 4, in this the entire plot happened of the box plot where keeping the mean as zero. So these things are like interesting, how more and more you get into the data and you get a more data if you are involved with. Okay, so as I told that this is a just a basic flavor of visualization tool. So more you can find it in the Matplotlib, their own website. They have lot of documentation you can go through, and in GitHub also they do keep on posting their new features and their new you know, the different articles and all. So you can also go and see the gallery where they will show you how the different plots can be, of what are the different new things they are coming up of. And also they will go for the different Matplotlib libraries, and the documentation is really good, the API thing that they have in their website. So I guess this is all about the visualization. So please come up with the questions if you have any.
I think there's no questions here. Just not check. So I think we can close for the day. And I am finding many in the Google OLAP. So they can take a screenshot. If you have done, you just take a screenshot and upload that screenshot that you have run the code. Do not put the IPython notebook the same one. You run the code and show that you have run the code. Take a screenshot of few of the lines, because in screenshot you cannot get the whole of the thing. Screenshot and just upload for that assignment. That will do. And for quiz also, just whatever score you have got, that score you just mention it and submit it. That's it. I think that itself will be fine. So again, I am repeating, for the code, take a snapshot once you have run the code and submit it as an attachment. And for the quiz part, just tell that you have done, and whatever the score you have got, you just put it, the score. That's it. Okay, then. Thank you,
Kilotama madam and Ikonika Barman Roy madam, for your sessions today. From morning onwards, you're continuous delivering your lectures, you're helping out the participants in solving their assignments.
Yeah, we are into the Google Classroom. Whenever you have any query, you please post it. We are time and again going through the Google Classroom. So tomorrow we will meet again. Thanks to all of you, all the participants.
Thank you, everyone. Tomorrow we'll meet at 10 o'clock, right, ma'am? 10 or 10:30?
No. Because there mentioned in the
schedule, it is 10:30.
Yes, there is scheduled 10:30. Yes, it is 10:30.
So we'll tomorrow all the participants have to join by 10:30. Join by 10:15, so that we can start the session at 10:30.
Yes, yes.
Thank you all. Thank you participants for your patient listening. Thank you, Tilottama madam and Uponika madam.
Okay.
All the participants, please fill the attendance form and the feedback form for day one. It's important. Only 27 participants have responded for have filled the attendance form. Please fill it. Thank you. Thank you all.